hello, everyone. Welcome to another edition of 15 Minutes. I'm Andrew Huff. We appreciate you joining us. My guest today in the studio is the newest director of the King County International Airport Boeing Field. He brings 4 decades of aviation experience to the position. My guest, John Parrott. John, thank you for joining us today.
Well, thank you for the opportunity. It's a pleasure to be here.
We appreciate you coming up here. Funny story, I told my mother that I was interviewing the newest director of King County Airport, and she said, "You tell him I am mad that they took away Anthony's restaurant." I said, "No, Mom, not SeaTac Airport. This is King County Airport Boeing Field." So just some clarification for that.
A common misconception.
Okay. You served for a number of years in Alaska at Ted Stevens International Airport. Served part of that as the director, probably every other job in between. How many years did you serve the airport, the Ted Stevens International Airport in Anchorage?
I was there for 19 years.
Okay, 19 years. And before moving to airport management, you also worked as a pilot in the U.S. Air Force. How many years did you serve?
20 years. 20 years flying aircraft.
And how long have you been a pilot for?
Oh, since 1979. So that's a long time.
About
40 years.
Tell us non-pilots, what kind of planes can you fly?
Well, I can tell you the kinds of planes I have flown.
Okay.
I'd probably need to brush up a little bit to take anybody up in them. But in the Air Force, I flew AT-38s, F-4s, F-16s, and B-1s. Since then, I've owned a PA-22 Tri-Pacer and a Cessna 180 on floats, wheels, and skis.
What point after being a pilot did you decide that I want to get into airport management and move into that position? Where were you at in your career when you made that decision?
Well, actually, when I retired from the Air Force, I felt there was one decision to make, and it was either to know what I wanted to do and move where that job was available, or know where I wanted to live and then see what jobs were available. I had been stationed in Anchorage prior in the Air Force, so that's where I wanted to live. So I moved to Anchorage and then began looking for jobs. And quite frankly, I was just fortunate enough that the security manager job at the airport opened up, and I applied and got the job, and 4 jobs later, was still hanging out at the airport 19 years later.
And here you are. You are now the head of one of the busiest non-commercial, non-hub airports, I guess I should say, in the country. Also serves as many things, the delivery point for the Boeing 737s. There's about 150 or businesses that are supported by the airport. Tell us a little bit about what businesses are supported by Boeing Field, the King County International Airport.
Sure, it really is a unique boutique airport, different than any other airports. And I know airport folks will always tell you, if you've seen one airport, you've seen one airport. But Boeing Field is truly different. Obviously, the Boeing Aircraft Company with 737s and the KC-46s and soon to be the 777Xs, all doing their test and final flights out of Boeing Field, is a huge part of the operation. We also have a significant operation with UPS running cargo in and out of the airport, and that operation is expanding. We have a number of private hangars with some very, very nice aircraft in them. And then we have also 2 fixed-base operators serving the corporate aviation world with Modern Aviation, formerly Clay Lacy, and Signature, and the NetJets operation. So a lot of Gulfstream and Learjet type operations. And then finally, last but certainly not least, we have the private aircraft, people in their Cessna 180s and their Cirruses, and private individual aircraft. And all of that comes together at Boeing Field.
So the private aircraft, these are people who can afford to have their own aircraft and want to keep it in a hangar at Boeing Field and come and go as they please.
In a hangar or tied out in the open.
And
those aircraft are not as expensive as a lot of cars folks are driving. So.
You know, when we were talking earlier, you mentioned something about Alaska, and that aircraft is one of the primary ways that you simply get around in Alaska because many areas, there simply are no roads.
That's correct.
How many aircraft would you say are coming and going around Alaska per day? You gave me a number, and it was just astounding.
Well, the Anchorage Airport had 1,000 small aircraft based there. Merrill Field, the downtown airport, had another 800. There's Birchwood about 5 miles to the north, which has a few hundred more, and that particular part of the world, if you're an airplane junkie, it's just an absolutely great place to be. There are a couple spots just north of the international airport where you can lay on the ground and look up, and within about 2 miles, you'll see a 1947 Taylor craft, you'll see a Cessna 180, You'll see a 747-8, a 777, a C-17, and an F-22, all flying to and from different airports in different directions, but all going right over your head.
You know, and I see that same kind of growth happening at the King County International Airport at Boeing Field, mm-hmm. where more and more people are simply buying aircraft. They either mm-hmm. can afford them, the personal aircraft, or just becoming more inexpensive. We have places to go in our state, such as the San Juan Islands, that mm-hmm. is many times it's just quicker to get there by aircraft. Are you seeing that sort of growth with personal aircraft at the airport as well?
We're not seeing a lot of it, but we are seeing growth. Obviously, we have Kenmore Air serving the islands from the airport, and we have another air carrier that's looking to come in this summer and provide connectivity with a little longer legged and more passenger aircraft, but not a typical commercial airline. So we see more demand. Obviously, the demand at SeaTac continues to grow, and is kind of some of the pressure relief that our airport offers that operation. I anticipate we're going to see continued demand.
You know, you have significant ties to the air travel industry, both in the commercial and passenger aircraft. Mm-hmm. What are the biggest challenges do you think that are going to come along with your job at Boeing Field?
Well, I think one of the challenges is trying to find the right balance of the diverse clients we have. What that person with his private aircraft needs and wants for the airport to be is not necessarily what Boeing wants the airport to be, and neither of those are necessarily what a corporate client wants the airport to be. But they all have important places at the airport, and so being able to balance those desires with always limited resources. One of our biggest limitations is land. We're a very small airport. And there's not a lot of place around the airport to grow. So we're looking at how to make the airport more efficient, how to use our leasing process to put together leases that make the most sense to get the maximum impact with our limited resources.
Is one way to do that is just the advance of technology? Does that make you more efficient as an airport?
It will. It will make us, though it will make the air traffic piece more efficient with next-gen satellite-based navigation. But you still have to have a certain amount of room on the ground to park the aircraft. And that's, in most cases, that's probably our limiting factor, is just square footage on the ramp to park aircraft.
How big is our airport?
About 650 acres total.
How's that compare to maybe other non-hub airports? On the smaller side?
It is on the smaller side. You know, if I think of maybe Centennial in Denver, some of those non-hub airports are significantly larger or don't have the demand. Most of those non-hub airports will not be running the number of operations that Boeing Field does.
Let me ask you kind of a personal question. You went through the interviewing process, you were offered the job, you had a decision to make. What are some of the reasons that you decided, I'm going to move to Seattle and run this airport? What led into that decision that you made?
I had had the opportunity to visit the airport about a year prior to that. Okay. And you just, when you walk into an organization or walk through an organization, you can kind of get a feel of is it a place where people like to come to work? Do people, if you're walking around with the boss, do people say hello? Are people friendly? And all of that was very positive. If you look at the terminal building, it's just absolutely a beautiful place to walk into work every day. Very historic, and just a great place to be. And then if you look at the area, Seattle has a lot to offer. It's not going to be the wilderness experience of Alaska, but it's going to have a lot of other things that Alaska doesn't have. And so we're, my family and I are looking forward to taking advantage of all those things.
You know, there's obviously changes that go on in any industry, and mm-hmm. certainly the air travel industry is one of those that has experienced a number of changes. One is just there's just simply more people flying, both commercial and passenger. Do you find that to be the case, or just more people in the air?
There are. And as a country, I think we sometimes take for granted the number of people that fly in the United States. If you compare our flying population to countries that have much, much larger total populations, they don't have as many people that fly. It's just not part of their culture. It is clearly part of the American culture, and it's affordable, and we have enough people with income that can afford to fly.
Yeah. I know that there are, the amount of planes that are being built is greater than I think at any time in our history. I mean, Boeing's putting out almost, what, 2 planes a day or something amazing. Is that what you're seeing as well? Is that because there's more passengers, airlines or manufacturers such as Boeing are just making more of these incredible aircraft and putting them in the air?
They are, and a lot of that is the global demand. If you look at still developing economies like China and barely developing economies like India, you know, both of them have about 1.3 billion people. We have about the 0.3 of that in this country. And yet we probably have, we certainly have many times more passengers flying than India, where the industry is just starting. And China is just experiencing incredible growth domestically, which needs aircraft to support, and pilots, and ground crew, and gate agents, and refuelers, and aircraft servicers, all that entire industry.
So just more people that are they need to hire. There's just more people that need that they need to support this industry. You have mentioned that technology has advanced to some degree in the aircraft industry. What has been the biggest advance in technology? And again, try and remember that you're speaking to some non-pilots here, but what is the biggest advance in technology specifically that you've seen in the airline industry?
I think probably the biggest one, and it's still ongoing, is the change from ground-based navigation to space-based navigation. It goes by a lot of names, GPS, ADS-B, Next Gen, but basically instead of back in the day when you flew across the western part of the United States, there were big pots on the ground with fires in them, and you would fly from one to the other, and that's how you'd know how to get where you wanted to go. And actually out in the desert southwest, there are still some cement arrows.
Is that right?
On the ground that were to tell the pilots which direction to go.
Next to the burning pots.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. And so that was the navigational system. And although we made it electronic, if you look at a VOR or a TACAN or other types of ground-based navigation, they're just long-range electronic versions of that same thing. When you go to space-based, it's completely different. Currently, the accuracy is just incredible. It can tell you within inches or centimeters of where you are. And in general, unless you're flying very low, it isn't interfered with by mountains, terrain, buildings, aircraft taxiing around and those kinds of things. And it has the ability to share that information, not only with the air traffic controller, but with other aircraft. Whereas in the past, you knew where you were. With radar, the controller knew where you were, but nobody else knew where you were.
Right.
Now, as a pilot, you can tell where everyone around you is and where they're going.
You know, on a personal note, you had mentioned that one of the most exciting places that you had been in your life was visiting Ireland.
Mm-hmm.
Where in Ireland did you visit? Tell me why it was such an incredible trip.
Well, it was just a lot of fun. We had planned it for a number of years, and the situation changed, and so we had a friend who was a deacon in the local Catholic Church, and he was born and raised in Ireland, so he took these tours every few years. So we went as part of his bus tour for 2 weeks, and I ended up going with my wife, a dear friend of hers, and her husband's sister, because he had passed away. So I was touring Ireland with three ladies for 2 weeks in a bus, and then we did 1 week on our own. And so in that amount of time, you ask where I went in Ireland. We went everywhere. In Ireland, because if you have 3 weeks, you can go everywhere, and I'm pretty sure I've been in every shoe store in the country,
and
some of them I know we went twice. But
why is that?
it was not because I was looking for shoes.
Okay, enough said.
But it's a beautiful country. Some of the most amazing topography and terrain. You know, the Cliffs of Moher, just and then the beautiful green fields. We got a chance to go horseback riding one afternoon across the fields, and it was a very nice trip.
A friend of mine spent a week just biking across Ireland, was not a big fan of Guinness beer, but when he came back, loved Guinness beer, was knocking back five at a time.
I have some in the fridge.
Well, Mr. Parrott, I appreciate you coming by, and
certainly,
congratulations on your new position.
Thank you very much.
In January of this year, as I understand.
Yes.
So the best of luck to you, and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for joining us, everyone. Join us again for another edition of 15 Minutes. We'll see you soon.